Who says you can't? You do, by Daniel Shidiok. Chapter 13. Fear, fan or foe? ? Too many people are thinking of security instead of opportunity. They seem to be more afraid of life than death. James F. Byrnes. As a child, if you woke up facing the wrong side of the bed, you would feel scared for that moment. Nothing looks the same. The place where you sleep every night suddenly seems out of the ordinary. Everything's out of place and panic begins to set in. But the more you start to focus and take a closer look, the more your surroundings begin to make sense. Relief takes over your emotional state and you realize you had nothing to panic about in the first place. In order to make peace with fear, we need to take a closer look. Throughout our life, we have been bombarded with the notion that fear is a foe that should be avoided at all cost. I am here to tell you that fear is actually the best friend some have never had. Fear has a tendency to send us unconscious messages that will benefit our life. Just like any best friend, it is telling you to step up and pick up your game. It might be in an area of your life that you are lacking in, and all fear is there to do is remind you that you should not forget about it and walk off. Think of it as your own success alarm clock that says, if you don't listen to me carefully in this instance, you can't get the most out of life. If we never get scared, it means we are not taking any chances. Being scared also tells us that something important is happening, right? ? We must search deeper into the feeling and listen carefully to what it's telling us. Once we have achieved that, we will be able to see a new way in which to take action against fear. The more we attempt to eliminate fear instead of using it to our benefit, the more it feels like trying to put out fire with gasoline. This creates more fire and more fear. As I was writing this book, I was scared that my writing was not up to scratch. There was a period when I thought I was losing my touch, and it began to worry me. Knowing that I had to quickly question this feeling, I began probing. I discovered that I was feeling fear of not knowing whether this would resonate with people from all different walks of life. I wanted it to be adaptable to everyone, regardless of financial, religious, and social position. I knew that I had to align myself with fear. And just as any good friend does, it reminded me when it was time to raise my standards. I went to people from all walks of life and gave them the same section to read. It was a chapter on questioning, and it seemed they were all fascinated. That was the power of getting to the heart of my feeling. Fear is looking at something with the worst possible outcome. Is someone really scared of snakes, or are they scared of getting bitten by a snake? Do they fear the tall building, or do they fear falling off the tall building? Are they really afraid of venturing into business, or are they afraid of failing? People are only scared of an outcome that is imaginary. The three initial questions I would ask are, first, what am I really scared of here? Rather than thinking I am scared, how can I view this differently, and what new beliefs would I have to implement in order for it to benefit my life? Would I have to believe that overcoming this fear is the only way to get the most out of life? How can I use this to take action and help myself grow again? It is a process of deep questioning rather than just accepting. This is how we grow and exceed our expectations. Let's say you have made an important appointment to be somewhere at 3 p.m. on Monday. When the day comes, you hop out of the shower and realize it's already 2:40 p.m. Fear starts to kick in because you just missed the bus. All the positive thinking in the world is not going to help you if the next bus comes at 2:55 p.m. So you now use the knee-jerk feeling of fear to support your action. You call the local taxi service and off you go. Your fear has taught you that next time you should plan better. This is a basic example, but one that seems to be very common in our society. In a sense, if we don't align ourselves with fear in everyday life, we will never learn, and we all know that learning equals growth. Don't resist fear, embrace it. You gain strength, courage, and confidence by every experience in which you really stop to look fear in the face. You must do the thing which you think you cannot do. Eleanor Roosevelt. You must give strong reasons as to why you want to overcome a particular fear. This will add purpose to its accomplishment. Replay these new reasons with intensity every time the fear comes to mind. If we have a fear of snakes, but common sense tells us that there are none around, does it mean we won't be scared from the thought of them? We definitely will be, because it's only ever in our mind. A particular client of mine would almost be in tears when her friend would say, "Hush, your day be just." Seems pretty funny, but hearing a noise similar to that a snake would make caused her to shake in her boots. By enforcing new reasons why you want to overcome the fear, you break your neurological pattern and get into a different state. Surprisingly, it does not take long to condition a new one. It can happen so quickly that I have seen pupils have it, phobias and fears literally disappear in 1 week. It sounds simple enough, but how many people do you think take the time to do it? Not many, I can tell you, or they will repeat. This stuff does not work because they don't believe how quickly they can turn their life around. In the face of fear, confidence is self-trust. The only way to build trust in your ability is to face and overcome your fears. I have always said there are two sides to ourselves, the scared guy and the inspirational guy. The scared guy is the weak one, and in the face of a fear, he will tremble, think his life is about to end, and look for the closest exit. The inspirational guy is trying to help you and will say, "You are not going anywhere, you are coming with me." He will drag you if he has to and make you stare at the fear straight in the face. The question is, how do you empower and grow your inspirational side and weaken the other one? We must counteract fear in any way possible. We all know that when we are feeding a baby, we don't shove two sticks down its throat to ensure nourishment. The aim is to build your strength, so act as soon as fear shows itself. But don't kill yourself in the process. Let's look at a treadmill. For example, most would initially see running on a treadmill as being painful, too hard, embarrassing, or a waste of time. In order for us to shift our mindset, we must first sort out our belief system. We would begin to see the treadmill as being very pleasurable. It would represent a healthy life, a fit-looking body, confidence, strength, a must in order to be successful, and a step toward achieving a lot of things on your wants list. The major tip is to feed this little by little, so you could start by walking. That's a different approach. Most would look at that equipment and automatically think running. which equals embarrassment and more pain. But start off by walking, and then suddenly it does not seem that hard. If you hit it really hard the first time, it could come as a big shock and cause even more pain. It will be more fun this way and more desirable the next time that a scared voice tells you to run away. You will eventually want to push yourself to the limits and be much stronger when faced with your limiting side. Courage is not the absence of fear, but rather the judgment that something else is more important than fear. James Neal Hollingsworth, aka Ambrose Redmond. Fear is also a physical emotion, so it means we have to counteract it with our body and get into a state of certainty. We know it's physical as much as mental and emotional because we feel fear throughout our whole body. You must get really physical and loud with yourself when encountering it. This rule can be applied to any fear we face, as we must learn to drag out the strength that lies within us. It's never a question of whether your strength is there, but whether what you do to drag it out. As time goes on and you begin to feed your strength, you will notice that you become fearful when you think of settling for the life that once made you unhappy. Just the thought of it pushes you to act even harder, because there is nothing scarier than living an undesired life once you have created a compelling vision of what you really want. First, ask yourself how you have overcome fears in the past. What did you do? Whom did you talk to? Who else has been in a similar situation and gotten through it? Second, shift beliefs around the certain experience or object. Add value to its accomplishment and make it pleasurable. Third, stay focused on the desired outcome. This will turn your fear into excitement. Counteract your fear immediately. Use your body to get into a different state to overpower it. Write down all the great things you can attain from overcoming this fear. Keep your eye fixed firmly on these benefits. Your fears will soon turn into challenges, and those will turn into excitement. Fear of achievement. At Microsoft, there are lots of brilliant ideas, but the image is that they all come from the top. I'm afraid that's not quite right. Bill Gates. I have heard so many people talk about top athletes, people who are worth a massive amount of money, or those who are in great relationship. They say things like, he was born to be a golfer, or she has always been a smart businesswoman. I know, because I used to join in those conversations. We say it as if these people has no real choice in the matter. In some way, we try to believe that it was planned out for them, and no matter which was they went in life, that's how they would have ended up. I don't see how any view could be so ignorant after witnessing the passion these people put into their success. If you are one of the people who have this thought, instead of lying to yourself and believing successful people are vastly different from you, I urge you to look fear in the face and prove yourself otherwise. Underachievers always pick out the few stories where people got everything on a silver platter and use that excuse when they hear of anyone achieving. For example, they will say things like, he has a rich dad, they were lucky, or she did that in an era when new ideas were available to create. We all know that's only an attempt to shade the lack of action they are taking in their own lives. It's nothing short of garbage. There are more young, innovative, self-made millionaires now than ever before. There is even a saying in the financial world that billionaire is the new millennial. It takes someone to be courageous and wise to recognize the hard work and determination of those who have achieved By acknowledging that truth, it helps you respect the game a whole lot more. It even promotes the understanding that you are not the only one who has experienced or will experience hardship on your road, and that's inspiring. That some achieve great success is proof to all that others can achieve it as well. Abraham Lincoln. Being guilty of undermining achievers myself in the past, I have now come to realize that my limiting thoughts were just me being afraid of achievement. I never believed I could be great, so it was easier to escape in fear than to face the truth. What I came to acknowledge is that the major difference with these great achievers is that they conquered that restrictive view of success. Were they born programmed with that powerful mindset? Was their journey a perfect walk? Some of the greatest achievers have been through experiences we would never trade for. Believe in the same world with the same capabilities. Look at Tiger Woods. Regardless of his off-field antics, the guy is the best at what he does. Playing golf. Of course, at the age of 5, he went on the show. That's incredible. And declared that by the age of 20, he would be the best golfer in history. Do you believe he ever lost sight of that vision? No matter what challenges came up, that vision stayed cemented. He continued to create his reality around that concept. This is a man who worked extremely hard for his achievement. Woods even asked his dad to give him military-style coaching. His dad would be in his face or use loud and annoying noise every time he went to swing. He would do anything to distract Woods in a moment of concentration. Toward the end of the intense program, Woods did not buzz when faced with these challenges, and his dad then told him that his training was complete. His father also mentioned that he now had the strongest golf mind on the planet. He was not wrong. Woods knew the importance of mental training so much that he even hired a mind coach, Dr. Jay Bunja, would make him sit down and visualize hitting perfect shots over and over. The same technique of visualization we are learning in this book. Woods built an absolute belief system around his process, and who is to say there are not 50 or 1,000 other potential better golfers than Tiger Woods. There may just be, but will they fight for their vision, or will they let their fear get in the way of achieving? Life is not to be feared or resisted. It is to be embraced, to be the best you can possibly be, and to live the life you dare to do. We see the effects of great achievers' success, like the money they spend and the way they live, yet we rarely take the time to find out how they did it. We ignore that these achievers are just normal men and women who decided to pursue their true potential. We neglect everything that came before: their persistence, their compelling visions, their passions, or the strength they had to build. All things needed to be considered. Albert Einstein once said, "I am not particularly intelligent or particularly talented. I am just very, very curious." Oprah Winfrey is a woman who was sexually abused and who lived in poverty as a child. But her passion for life became so overwhelming that she had to live it the best way she knew how. The guys from Google are another example of defying the odds and starting off small in their garage. Competing against Yahoo, the larger company at the time, it almost seems impossible to think that someone could actually achieve so much in one lifetime, let alone a few years. They all came to a point in their life where they decided they would never settle, but rather go on a quest for their dreams, no matter what challenges came their way. When you surrender to this commitment, The world smiles with you and you get breaks you never believed possible. You don't have to want to make billions or even millions of dollars. It is entirely up to you. It's well, whatever makes you happy. Just understand that taking a chapter out of the book of some of the greatest is the best start to obtaining what you want. I have researched and met some of the greatest succeeders I know, and there are patterns this book is based on, those very patterns. They are stopped thinking, speaking, acting, and believing that they had no purpose in this world, and began learning how to add value. They learned to use fear to grow, researched what successful people did before them, and lived by the exact strategies and values you are reading, rather than escape in their fear. Appreciating other people's success is vastly important when enhancing our own. Being jealous or in disbelief will distance you from ever understanding the qualities you have within you. We must look at them and find out what they did differently from everyone else. As soon as you start doubting them or believe that it was luck or coincidence, you fall back into the mass of underachievers. When you start to question and get intrigued by others' success, that's when you enter the minority of the greatest achievers in the world. Every person who wins in any undertaking must be willing to cut off sources of retreat. Only by doing so can one be sure of maintaining that state of mind known as burning desire to win essential to success. Napoleon Hill. This is the end of chapter 13, page number 168. Thank you very much for listening. Have a nice day.